Morning, church. And to all those of you who are joining us online or at home, we say thank you and welcome for your presence. Happy Thanksgiving as well. Happy Thanksgiving. Thank you. Even though we're all probably still in our turkey comas, that's okay. We can still share. But hopefully you had a blessed weekend. Today is a special Sunday in which we will be welcoming new members. And we do want to just thank you for your presence today. A couple of announcements that we want to share is we still have our stewardship table up. If you have not been able to offer a pledge, we would encourage you to do so. There are pledges available, and you can place them in the pledge box. And we are starting Advent next week, and we have our Advent devotionals called The Gifts of Christmas, and we're going to be looking at the four gifts that we receive on Christmas. And so it's a free devotional for you to take. It'll start next Sunday, so we encourage you to take those as you are able. Also want to highlight that tomorrow morning at 8:30, people are going to gather here to help set up for the Christmas season and the Advent season, so encourage you to come as you are able for that. Tomorrow night is our Strive group, and we are meeting at 6 o'clock at the Owens for dinner and a discussion around the table. And so we encourage you to come to that if you are able. And I think pretty much everything else is you can read as you are able to do so. But we are, again, thankful for your presence here today. And so now let us worship our Lord and Savior in spirit and in truth. And I would invite you to stand for our opening hymns, hymn number 81, We Gather Together, and hymn number 359, We Give Thanks.
Thank you. Dear God, open our hearts and minds to receive your word and to strengthen our relationship with our Lord and Savior. Thank you for blessing us today as we gather before you on this beautiful day. Amen. You may be seated, and our New Testament lesson is on page 109. It's John 14, verses 15 through 21. I am the true vine, and my Father is the vine grower. He removes every branch in me that bears no fruit. Every branch that bears fruit, he prunes to make it bear more fruit. You have already been cleansed by the word, and I have spoken to you. Abide in me as I abide in you, just as the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine. Neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Those who abide in me and I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me, you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask for whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and become my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lie down one's life for another, for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. This is the word.
Thank you, Gary, for that. It is now time in our service in which we will welcome our new members. You'll see that we have three new members that we are welcoming into the congregation today. So I'd like to invite forward Mark and Tracy Olson and Vandy Newman. They are all joining this church as with letters of transfer from other congregations. So we're thankful to have them. And I'll have you come stand here. We'll stay on the ground level. So we do, we're happy to be able to present them before you. And on behalf of the session, we now offer them to you. They have attended our new members class and have expressed their desire to join our congregation. And they have been received into the membership of this church by a letter of transfer from our session. And it is our book of order that describes membership in these ways. In Jesus Christ, God calls people to faith and to membership in the church, the body of Christ. Baptism is the visible sign of that call and claim on a human life and of entrance into the membership of the church. The baptism of children witnesses to the truth that God's love claims people before they are able to respond in faith. The baptism of those who enter the covenant of membership upon their own profession of faith in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior witnesses to the truth that God's gift of grace calls forth the response of faithfulness. Thus, the triune God, incarnate in life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, gives to the church not only its mission, but also its understanding of membership. Now, to those of you who are seeking membership, You come as members of the Holy Universal Church, into which you have been baptized and by which you have been nurtured. We are one with each other, sisters and brothers in the family of God. And we do rejoice in the gifts that God gives to you to bring to this congregation. And it is fitting together that we reaffirm our baptismal covenant into which we have been baptized, claiming again the promises of God which are ours in baptism. Ephesians 4 says this, "There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, and one God, and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all." And so therefore, I now will ask you once again to reject sin and to profess your faith in Jesus Christ and to confess the faith of the universal church in which you were baptized. So who is your Lord and Savior? Do you trust in Him? If so, please say, "I do." Do you intend to be His disciple, to obey His word, and to show His love? If so, please say, "I do." Now, trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? If so, please say, "I do." Will you be faithful members of this congregation, giving of yourself in every way, and will you seek the fellowship of the church wherever you may be? If so, please say, "I will, with God's help." Way to go. And now, as a sign of our unity of the church, we would ask for you to extend your arm forward as you are able, as we pray over our newest members of this congregation. Holy God, we praise you for calling us to be a servant people and for gathering us into the body of Christ. We thank you for choosing to add to our number these brothers and sisters in faith. Together may we live in your spirit and so love one another that we may have the mind of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom we give honor and glory forever. Amen. And I have some certificates for each one of you. Mandy, here you go. Congratulations. Tracy. Thank you. There you go. And Mark. And before we give them a round of applause, I do encourage you to come up and introduce yourself. Today, we're all wearing our membership name tags, right? Great. Why is everybody looking down? But indeed, let's welcome them into this church. They, the Olsons were married here over 20 years ago, and now they've come back, and so we're thankful for them. And Vandy Newman has been with us for over a year now, I believe, and been so faithful in participating in a lot of what we do. So let's welcome them with a round of applause. And we will welcome them in friendship and fellowship following the service as well. So thank you. We do thank our spirit ringers, doing a wonderful job, as always. And now it is our time during the service in which we come together for a time of prayer. And so I would ask if there are any joys or concerns that we would like to pray for today. Yes, Cindy? Okay, all right. Well, we celebrate with Hernandez and the Mumpson family on the birth of Charles. Congratulations on your first grandson. But we also pray for Pete, who has been placed on hospice after a recent diagnosis with leukemia. I also had one announcement shared with me today. Grant Barron, where are you at, Grant? Oh, he's hiding back up there. Grant turned 10 yesterday, so we celebrate his birthday. And are there any other prayers or praises we would like to offer? Okay, we'll let it up. Oh, yep, Karen? Okay, and that was, okay, so Janice Bond, we will be praying for her. She is going to be having her surgery for cardiac aneurysm has been postponed until Tuesday, so we will keep her in our prayers. Yes, Cindy. Okay. Okay, and her name? Okay, we'll be praying for Emily Kester, who will be having a double mastectomy this upcoming week.
She already had it.
Okay, and so they're waiting for results. Okay, she is on our list, so we'll keep praying for Nikki Nelson. She's struggling with the rash from her antibiotics, so she's had about a good 2-week period where she's been pretty sick. So we'll lift up Nikki Nelson. And I think we had one more back here. Yes, Celine? Okay, wonderful. And so we do, it is one of the ministries of this church. We collect coins through the Presbyterian women, and then those are matched out of their funds, and they go directly to supporting our food pantry. So if you got loose change laying around, bring it in. We got a big bucket in the fellowship hall. So let us now go before our God in prayer. Our Heavenly Lord, we thank you for the many blessings that you give us. This last weekend, we were able to celebrate Thanksgiving with the world around us. We thank you for the provisions that you give us, the families that we are a part of, and the love and the community that we walk within. But God, we also realize that during this time of thankfulness, we also acknowledge that there's still deep pain, struggle, and hurt that is taking place in this world and in our lives. So now, Lord, we know that you are listening with attentive ears and loving arms, and we pray that you will hear us during this time of silent meditation as we lift our concerns to you. Hear our prayers, O Lord. And Lord, we thank you for responding to these needs. And we know, God, that you are continuing to work in our lives and the lives of those around us to bring healing, to bring restoration, and to bring redemption. And so, God, we also want to lift up those names that have been brought before us. We thank you so much for Carol Young and hearing from Rick today. She is doing great in recovery. Her rehabilitation. She's without pain from her hip, and so we celebrate with her, Lord. God, we want to pray for Eleanor Johnson, who's been hospitalized. We lift up Howard Torgerson, who is struggling with pancreatic cancer. We pray for Jeremy Olson and his family, whose uncle James passed away from a heart attack recently. Ask that you will hold them in your arms during their grief. We pray for Janice Bond, who will be having surgery this Tuesday for a cardiac aneurysm. We pray for the continued healing and recovery of Terry Briggs, as well as Nikki Nelson, who is still struggling with the rash. We pray, Lord, for blessings upon her life. We lift up Matt Hoff's uncle Larry, who's surgery has been postponed, but they're still hopeful that that'll take place. But we just pray for your provision in that situation. We lift up Mason, who is struggling with pain after surgery, and ask, Lord, that you will hold him in your arms, as well as be with Roy, recovering from knee surgery. And we just ask that you will bring your healing hand to his life. Lord, we do want to pray for Pete, who is in hospice now for leukemia, and we ask God that you will hold him in your arms. We pray for Emily Kester, who is recovering from a double mastectomy, and the results will be coming soon. We just pray for your strength and healing for her. And Lord, we also celebrate the joys of life. We lift up Grant Barron, who turned 10 yesterday. And thank you for just the spirit that he shares with all of us. We pray for the Mumpson family on the birth of Charles Hernandez. And we thank you so much for the gift of life that you have poured into that family. And we do, Lord, thank you for our newest members and celebrate their inclusion in this congregation. And we know, Lord, that you will use their gifts to bring about your will and bring your peace to this congregation. And we also pray for the PW ministry of collecting coins and having that go to the food bank or our food pantry. And so we ask that you will continue to bless that ministry. And so, Lord, we thank you for all that you do in our lives. We appreciate the blessings that you pour out upon us. And we do praise you for the gift of your Son and our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is in his name that we pray. And now, Lord, we pray the prayer that Christ taught us to pray by saying the Lord's Prayer, which is on the screen behind us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now as we invite the ushers forward to receive this morning's offering, let us give out of the blessings that God has given us. Lord, we pray for the use of these gifts. May they be used in such a way that brings about your kingdom here on earth, so that all may know your love and all may experience your grace. We pray this in your name. Amen. Before you take a seat, turn to your neighbors and give them the peace of Christ this morning. And as you take your seat, I'd invite the children up for the children's sermon with Laura Carlson this morning.
Good morning. Oh, good. I get the big kids too. Perfect. Thank you for coming up because I have questions for you to answer today. As most of you know, we've already been practicing our Christmas pageant. Can you remember the name of the pageant?
Carriers of the Light.
Carriers of the Light. We've been learning the songs, and we are about to read the script today, starting today. So what story is being told in our Christmas pageant? The story of Jesus' birth. Why do you think we tell the same story every year? It is so important. It is the reason we have Christmas in the first place. It's about our Savior coming into the world, Emmanuel, which means God with us. See how smart these kids are? And who are some of the characters in this nativity story? Jesus, Mary, Joseph, the angel, Gabriel, and angels.
Donkeys.
Oh, yes. Do not forget the animals. Shepherds. King. King Herod. Yep. And the wise men. Good. We get the honor of portraying each one of these characters in our Christmas pageant, and we need each character to present the full and the sacred story. So all children and youth, ages 3 through 12th grade, are important for our pageant. That's why you have received or are receiving a postcard in the mail with the saying, all hands on deck. That expression was used to signal all crew members on board a ship that their help was needed immediately. Now we use it to say that it requires everyone to work hard in order to achieve a goal. So children and youth, please come participate with us by practicing on Sunday mornings during Sunday school time, and on Wednesday nights when we will also share pizza for dinner. Because together on December 17th, we are going to share the good news of Jesus' birth. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for sending your son to us. Let every heart prepare him room. Let us be carriers of your light. Jesus, you are our hope and our salvation. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you, Laura. Indeed, all hands on deck. And so the children are now dismissed to go back to their time in which they will learn more about the pageant. So, and as they do that, I would like you to open your pew Bibles up into the Old Testament, page 621, Ecclesiastes 12, 9 through 14. Can I get a big cheer that we have reached the end of Ecclesiastes? It's been a wonderful book, but it has been a directed book in sometimes some challenging messages. But I think it's truly been a blessing to progress through this book. But now we have an opportunity to hear some final words. In your Bibles, it is probably labeled as an epilogue, but it is a summary of all that King Solomon was indeed trying to tell us through this book. So let us read now verses 9 through 14. Besides being wise, the teacher also taught the people knowledge, weighing and studying and arranging many proverbs. The teacher sought to find pleasing words, and he wrote words of truth plainly. The sayings of the wise are like goads, and like nails firmly fixed are the collected sayings that are given by one shepherd. Of anything beyond these, my child, beware. Of making many books there is no end, and much study is a weariness of the flesh. The end of the matter, all has been heard. Fear God and keep His commandments, for that is the whole duty of everyone. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every secret thing, whether good or evil. So we do praise God for His word this morning. Amen. Well, do you ever ask yourself that famous old age question, what is the meaning of life? We as humans, I think, long for this desire to truly understand what life is all about. And if anybody's got any answers, please share it with me. For early on in my life, I was concerned with the question about the meaning of everything. But now, as I progress in the years, I'm much more caught up in dealing with the reality of the aches and pains of life than trying to figure it all out. I'm just hoping I can get out of bed in the morning sometimes. And after this weekend, another question arose. I'm still trying to figure out why I bought a 20-pound turkey to feed my family of five. So if anyone wants leftovers, we've got plenty. But even though we can never truly answer that question, what is the meaning of life, it is still good for us to consider the value and the purpose and the best way of living the life that God has given us. In fact, this has been a question that has consumed the church throughout its history. And I believe one of the best answers has been given a long time ago in what's called the Westminster Catechism. And we, our church, we derive our name from that Westminster Catechism, or what's called the Westminster Confessions. And it is a brilliant piece of literature that was meant to teach the church about what faith truly was. And it was written in 1643 by English reformers. And the opening question was this: what is the chief and highest end of humanity? Or in modern day tongue, what is the meaning of life? And their answer was simply, humanity's chief and highest end is to glorify God and fully enjoy Him forever. So our highest end and our greatest value simply comes by glorifying our God and enjoying Him forever. So if you want to answer the question that we started with, this is a pretty good way to go. And this was also the tact of our author in Ecclesiastes. King Solomon spent his entire book of wisdom trying to answer that question, the meaning of life. Let's remember back to where we started in Ecclesiastes verse 1 and 2, or chapter 1, verse 2. And he says, meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Life is utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. This is how he started this wisdom writing. And so the teacher, Solomon, as he identifies himself, spent his entire book, this entire writing, trying to answer that question. And throughout the book, as you remember, he made four conclusions. The first was that he would speak of the vanity or the meaninglessness of life. Then he spoke much about the vanity of wisdom. He described the futility of wealth, and then he proclaimed the certainty of death. But it wasn't until these final verses that he finally gave us an answer. His goal was to allow us to reach the conclusion that he wanted to provide, and to reach that conclusion on our own. And so he says at the end of this book, Verse 13. Now that all has been heard, the conclusion on the matter is this. Fear God, keep His commandments, for this is the duty of humanity. Solomon is finally, as my sermon title says, getting to the point. And one of our staff members this week, he told me after he saw the title of the sermon, he said, "Congratulations, Mike. You've been preaching on this since the beginning of September, and now you're finally getting to the point." I'll let you guess who he is on your own. But this is exactly what is happening. Solomon ends this great thesis on life, and he gives us a conclusion. He doesn't leave us wafting in the wind, struggling with the meaninglessness or vanity that he so often proclaimed. He gives us the central truth that we were to arrive at, and that is to fear God and to keep His commandments. This is the conclusion that he comes to as to the real, the true meaning of life. One commentator shared this. He said, "The task of wisdom is joined with the task of the Torah when we understand the meaning of life." And for me, I've understood that is meaning is found when wisdom meets the law. And that's the final lesson that we are called to learn. And so that is what is presented here in this epilogue. Some believe this epilogue was written by a later author, but regardless of the author, it carries forth the true meaning of the book. And it reinforces the value and the strength that all that had been written prior to it. And so these words remind us that they have come from God, they are upright and true, and they should serve to every believer as a guide and a standard for the journeys that we are all to take. The author likens this to a shepherd prodding his sheep. He uses the term goad and nails to encourage us. That was a process of a shepherd or a farmer encouraging their livestock, their sheep or their ox, to move in the right direction. It was a long stick with a point end or a point on the end that was used to not only correct, but to guide and to shape. And so that is what these words are doing. And in fact, the author in verse 11 gives us this warning. He says, "Be admonished," or more directly, "be guided against falling into the traps of the world." We are to avoid the endless writings and the worrisome studies that will come our way. They will test our flesh and they will try to lead us astray. But in order to avoid these pitfalls, we are to do the two things that we are told in verse 13. Fearing God and obeying His commandments. Sounds pretty simple. We might wonder why it took him 12 chapters to get to this point. But the problem is, as much as we hear them, as simple as they seem, they are so very challenging to live out. And so the purpose of this book, I believe, was to give us the wisdom and the insight to understand how to truly live out verse 13, to fear God and to obey God. For that is the work that Solomon undertook at the beginning of this writing. We are to fear God, we are to obey Him. And so I want to break this down briefly. The first aspect, fearing God. Oswald Chambers, a wonderful theologian and author, wrote this. He said, "The remarkable thing about fearing God is that when you fear God, you fear nothing else. But when you do not fear God, you fear everything else." And Solomon, Proverbs 1:7, said the same. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. So as we are called to fear God, what does that mean for us? What is this fear that we should have? Well, the Hebrew word for fear is yirah. And it's much different than our understanding of terror or panic or fright. The Hebrew word involves the context of a sense of awe, a reverence, a respect, a worship, and even a sense of trembling as well. We see that trembling in the birth narrative. When the angels come and confront the shepherds, Mary, Joseph, they tremble in fear. But it is not a fear of terror that we should have towards our God. Have you ever stood out and looked across the Grand Canyon? I know I have. Have you ever gone deep into the woods of the Boundary Waters area? Have you ever stood on the tallest of mountains and looked down? And have you ever considered the intricacies of a single human cell or watched a caterpillar change into a butterfly? If you have, then hopefully you understand what it means to fear God. We see this in His power, His might, His glory in the world around us. But we also see in how He pours Himself out into the smallest details of our lives and how much He loves each and every one of us. This is what it means to fear God, to have faith in Him, to trust Him, and to know that He will never leave us. Last weekend, my wife and I went up to Two Harbors north of Duluth, and we got a small little cabin sitting right on the edge of Lake Superior. We do this once a year to have a time in which we get away to read, to talk, to walk, to pray, to study. And this time was a wonderful time for us, except I picked up this cold that isn't so fun. But for me, as I was reflecting, a single word kept coming to mind, and that word was trust. That is what God was teaching me. And I believe that's what fear of in God means. That we trust in Him for all that we are. Again, Solomon in the Proverbs said this, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding, but in all your ways submit to Him and He will make your paths straight." This is what the fear of God is again. Trusting in Him and not in yourself. Submitting to Him and not to the world. Walking in His paths and not walking on our own paths. That is how we fear God. Going to another one of the great confessions of the church, this time from 1560, the Scots Confession. This is their understanding of fearing God. We confess and we acknowledge one God alone, to whom alone we must cleave, whom alone we must serve, whom only we must worship, in whom alone we put our trust. God is eternal, infinite, immeasurable, incomprehensible, omnipotent, invisible, one substance and yet three distinct persons, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. This is how we fear God, by acknowledging Him, cleaving to Him, serving Him, worshiping Him, and trusting in Him. And so we fear God, but then we are called to keep His commandments. Well, we have looked at what it means to fear God, but what does it mean to obey God? Well, simply, it's to do the will and the work of our Lord. Jesus tells us this, that Gary read for us in John 15:12. And it says, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, than to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friend if you do what I command." See, obeying God means loving God. Just as fearing God meant trusting God, now when we want to obey Him, we must love Him. And that is the beautiful picture of love that Christ gave. A portrait of Himself, but also a portrait of what He asks of each one of us. To be obedient to Him means to be obedient to others by loving them and laying down our lives for them. This is what obedience truly is love. And you can't have one without the other. To love without obedience is just feathery love that really has no substance to it. But to be obedient without love is simply living under the letter of the law rather than the spirit of the law. We are called to obey our God by first and foremost by loving Him and then loving others. And again, this is summed up in another one of our great confessional statements, the Heidelberg Catechism, where it says, "What is your only comfort in life and death?" The answer is that I am not my own, but I belong, body and soul, in life and in death, to my faithful Jesus, to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. And so what does that mean? It means we are to love our God in obedience. That is our message today, to fear Him and to obey Him. It's when we do that that we truly can have victory over the vanity of life. And it is only then that we can truly follow after our God, a path that leads to eternal victory and to His eternal glory. Let us pray. Lord, we thank You for the blessing of this word, of this book that You have given us, in which we have been challenged in so many ways. But God, we are finally called to understand and to remember that life is about worshiping You, fearing You, trusting in You, and then ultimately obeying You by loving You and loving others. That is our calling as believers, Lord. And I pray that is the direction our lives can take as we walk with You. We pray this in Your name. Amen. Well, I'd ask you to stand now to sing our closing hymn out of our supplemental hymnals. That's the folders that are in your pew racks. We're going to open to page 9 and 10 to sing "Wonderful, Merciful Savior."
Thank you.
Following the benediction, you're all invited into the fellowship hall for a time of treats and fellowship and to welcome our new members. The children will be rehearsing at 10:45 down in the youth room and the choir room back there. And we are going to be having Beyond the Pulpit at 11 o'clock in the parlor. And so now let us receive the benediction. May we fear God, may we obey God, and may we live in His presence as we go forth in the power and protection of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.